congregation rises as you are able, as together we begin with the order for confession and forgiveness, which you can find on the inside front cover of your hymnal. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess
that we have turned from you, giving ourselves into the power of sin, and we are truly sorry and humbly repent.
In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done and things we have failed to do.
Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with the power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. We sing as our gathering hymn number 264, Prepare the Royal Highway.
Thank you.
Kyrie on page 138, and then our Advent wreath song, In a Far Off Place, on the inside. Oh,
yeah. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above, and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Me bragging about my shoes that I painted all over, but I'm not just bragging about what I have today. I want to share something with you. you. We have very, very special buttons. I've been wearing mine already today, and I'm going to give it to you, but I'm wondering if there's anybody who's able to read what it says. Can you tell me what that says?
Love is on the way.
Love is on the way. Excellent reading job. I'm going to invite each of you to take one of these today, and you can wear it wherever you wear buttons, you know, school, at home, with friends, neighbors, store, wherever, as a way of helping get people's attention that something good, something exciting, something wonderful is coming. I bet you can think of a day that's coming up not too far away that you're kind of excited about. Is there a day you're thinking of? Maybe, I don't know, a little less than 3 weeks away, anybody's excited about? Yeah, oh, what is it?
Christmas,
yes, exactly. And I'm guessing you already know that while it's super exciting to have trees and presents and songs and cocoa and all that, you know that Christmas is about Jesus coming into the world. And before Jesus came onto the scene, before Jesus started publicly going around and bringing the kingdom of God to people, God sent somebody to get ready, whose job was like to be a walking, talking button saying, love is on the way, folks. His name was John the Baptizer. We call him that because he baptized people and we're not terribly creative. Anyway, John's job was that everywhere he went, tell people, guess what? Good news. Love is on the way. God's finally coming among us in a new way, and it's worth paying attention. Get ready. He was just there to get people excited and keeping their eyes open. But John wasn't the only person who's supposed to do that. That's our job, too. Our job isn't to be the center of attention. I'm not supposed to walk down the street going, hey, everybody, look at me. I'm so awesome. Our job is to walk down the street going, Jesus is coming. He's awesome. Love is on the way. So I'm going to give one of these to you, and you are dared. You are invited, when you wear it, to help when somebody asks, what does it mean love is on the way? You can tell them, well, good news. Jesus is on the way, and Jesus coming means God's love has come to us. Sound like a deal? All right. Take your pick. They're all identical. Can I offer you a button? Can I offer you a button, sir? Perfect. Okay. Can I offer you a button? Can I offer you a button? Perfect. Wonderful. And any grown-ups who like one, there's going to be in the basket out in the social hall after worship as well. So you too can tell your friends and neighbors and strangers, love is on the way. Now that we've all got our buttons and we're all ready, how about we pray together right where we are? Ready? Dear Jesus, thank you so, so much for coming among us. We're so excited to celebrate your coming at Christmas. But beyond that, we're excited that you love us and you come to meet us where we are. Thank you, not just for coming to us, but for sending people like John who help get our attention, who say in their words and their actions that your love is on the way. Now help us to be people who share that news with the people around us, not just by buttons that we wear, but in the words and actions in our lives that point people to you. Thank you for that love, Jesus. We love you too. Amen. Thank you all so, so much for coming up. See you around with your buttons.
Says the Lord of hosts. But who can endure the day of his coming, and who can stand when he appears? For he is like a refiner's fire and like a fuller's soap. He will sit as a refiner and the purifier of silver, and he will purify the descendants of Levi and refine them like gold and silver, until they present offerings to the Lord in righteousness. Then the offering of Judah and Jerusalem will be pleasing to the Lord, as in the days of old and as in the former years, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm for today is psalm from Luke 1. I will read the regular print and you will respond with the bold print. It's in your bulletin. Blessed are you, Lord, the God of Israel. You have come to your people and set them free.
You have raised up for us a mighty Savior, born of the house of your servant David.
Through your holy prophets, you promised of old to save us from our enemies, from the hands of all who hate us.
To show mercy to our forebears, and to remember your holy covenant.
This was the oath you swore to our father Abraham to set us free from the hands of our enemies.
Free to worship you without fear, holy and righteous before you, all the days of our life.
A new child shall be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare the way.
People knowledge of salvation by the forgiveness of their sins.
In the tender compassion of our God, the dawn from on high shall break upon us.
To shine on those who dwell in darkness and in the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the way of peace.
Amen.
Our second reading is from Philippians chapter 1, verses 3 through 11. I thank my God every time I remember you, constantly praying with joy in every one of my prayers for all of you, because of your sharing in the gospel from the first day until now. I am confident of this, that the one who began a good work among you will bring it to completion by the day of Jesus Christ. It is right for me to think this way about all of you, because you hold me in your heart, for all of you share in God's grace with me, both in my imprisonment and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel. For God is my witness how I long for all of you with the compassion of Christ Jesus. And this is my prayer, that your love may overflow more and more with knowledge and full insight to help you to determine what is best, so that in the day of Christ you may be pure and blameless, having produced the harvest of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ for the glory and praise of God. Word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. During the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. He went into all the region around the Jordan, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sin. As it is written in the book of the words of the prophet Isaiah, the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Every valley shall be filled, every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough ways made smooth, and all flesh shall see the salvation of God. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
The congregation may be seated.
Would you play a game with me this morning, just briefly? If you're sitting in front of a large screen, and the first words that appear in little blue type say, a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away, what are you watching?
Star Wars.
Star Wars, exactly, good. So if you recognize that, you know you are in for a space opera with laser swords and all sorts of curious aliens. If that's your favorite kind of movie, great. You are about to enjoy 2.5 hours of it. If not, buckle up. It's going to be a long ride with space lasers. If you are watching a different screen and you hear an opening monologue that says, space, the final frontier, these are the voyages of the Starship Enterprise, what are we watching? Star Trek, right? And again, the opening crawl tells you this is the kind of show this is. This is not going to be a telenovela, this is not going to be a game show, this is not going to be the nightly news either. This is telling you stories about spaceships flying all around the galaxy. Similarly, maybe if you have ever watched, say, a show that begins, again, black screen, and these words, in the criminal justice system, the people are represented by two separate but equally important groups, the police officers who investigate crimes and the district attorneys who prosecute them. What are we watching?
Law
and order, right? You know that, right? And not only does that introduce what the show is, but it tells you again, this is the kind of story that's going to be told. It's going to be fictional, but there's probably not going to be space lasers. This is not going to be in a galaxy far, far away. This is in a world like ours with real cases or realistic kinds of cases that could happen in the real world. Maybe you can remember in a previous era this opening line too. Do not attempt to adjust your TV set. We have control of your set. We control the horizontal, we control the vertical. Anybody know that opening? The Outer Limits, which was a cousin of the Twilight Zone. Twilight Zone had its own opening crawl that would sometimes go, welcome to a new dimension beyond sight and sound, the dimension of the imagination. Welcome to the Twilight Zone. Now, when you watch an opening of a show like that, you know it's there both to tell you what kind of a show you are watching and kind of like to prime you. This is the kind of world where, this is the kind of show where this kind of thing can happen. In a similar way, anybody who has ever tucked in a childhood bedtime story that opens with Once Upon a Time, do you know that's kind of sort of teaching our children, okay, this is not the nightly news, this is not me reciting the family rules, this is a made-up story. Once Upon a Time is sort of a clue, this is a fairy tale, this is going to be the kind of story where there can be dragons and princesses and possibly witches and wizards and maybe a big bad wolf or two, and everything will all have a happy ending, they will all live happily ever after. You know that from the beginning, just with Once Upon a Time, right? We do that in all kinds of storytelling, whether it's on the big screen or the small screen or books that we read or read to children. We do that as a way of preparing them for here's the kind of story you are about to experience. And in really good storytelling, it's meant to grab somebody's attention, sort of a preview, but also to prepare you, this is the kind of story you're about to experience, right? If you are watching the nightly news and they say, and there was a dragon and a princess, no, that doesn't sound right. But in a fairy tale, okay, that's the kind of world we're talking about. This is the kind of story where I'm not supposed to question there's dragons and princesses. Or, oh, we're watching Star Wars, that's why there's all these strange alien creatures and laser swords. That kind of thing. Kind of similar to how if you watch the musical, whether on a movie version or on stage, the opening you'll get is the overture that will play for you melodies you'll hear throughout the whole show to get you ready. Oh, yay, that song is coming up. But also to remind you, this is the kind of story where people are going to break into song and dance. Don't be worried about it. You're not supposed to question the reality and go, how do they all learn those words? How do they learn those dance moves? It's a musical. That's just how this kind of story goes, right? So, basic rule of storytelling. You want to do something early on to grab your listener or reader or viewer's attention that will tell them what kind of story they are about to experience and grab their attention as well, right? The basic storytelling 101. You want to know what won't get people's attention? You want to know what won't get your show renewed for a second season on Netflix? A long recitation of historical figures who happen to be in power at the time when your story takes place. You want to grab people's attention Once Upon a Time and say, ooh, there could be dragons, there could be monsters, Once Upon a Time in a galaxy far, far away. That gets my attention. But in the 15th year of Emperor Tiberius, when Lysanias was ruler of Abilene, my goodness, it's automatically harder to pay attention. When I was in college, I had a journalism professor. He used to make fun of his students every time we wrote a boring opening line of a sample article for an assignment. If he wrote something that was boring, he'd pretend to be like the man reading the newspaper and yelling at his wife about the exciting headline. And he, this is the exact kind of thing. He'd go, Mabel, get in here! Lysanias is ruler of Abilene, have you heard? The opening of the third chapter of Luke doesn't feel like any of those other kinds of stories. And if we were grading it in terms of how does it grab your attention, my guess is we'd flip the channel or pick a different movie to watch. And yet, I don't think Luke is interested in just entertaining us. I don't think he's here to amuse us, and I don't think he's trying to tell us a bedtime story either. I want to assume, think this is a safe assumption. The scriptural writers know what they're doing when they tell us things the way they do. And that if we start scratching our heads or yawning when we read something, it's worth us asking, what's going on here? Why would this have been so, so important for the biblical writer? So we were treated today to hear the opening of the third chapter of Luke, which began, as you heard, with a long recitation of historical figures who happened to be in power. They were religious and political bureaucrats who happened to be in power in the time when John the Baptizer appears on the scene. And Luke has done his homework. He gives us who's the emperor, Tiberius. He's got Pontius Pilate was the governor from Rome of Judea, and Herod was ruler of Galilee. And his brother Philip was ruling Trachonitis and Ituria, and of course Abilene. Lysanias was ruler of Abilene, even down to who is the high priest at this time. Not because he's convinced this is a barn-burning story, but because he knows he's telling us something grounded in history and real. It's like the opposite of once upon a time. When you hear the words once upon a time, some part of your brain goes, oh, I don't have to worry about anything that doesn't seem realistic in this story. This isn't about real people. This is princesses and possibly singing princesses and dragons and wizards and things like that. But when somebody starts telling you, here are real people who live in the real world. When they were in power, this is what happened. Here's Luke saying, what I'm about to tell you is real. Not a myth, not a fable, not a legend, which is to say, when I tell you that God enters this story in the person of Jesus, when I tell you that God raised up a spokesperson in John, I'm telling you it really happened in our real world, not in a galaxy far, far away full of other people, not far off in some distant future, not in a mythical past with castles and dragons, in the world you and I live in. That's where God enters. That's important, not only for Luke in his day, but in ours as well. Of course, back in Luke's day, there were plenty of stories and fables and legends everybody had heard before, but that most everybody knew weren't real, right? If you lived in the first century where Luke lived, you had grown up hearing, you know, stories we still tell our kids, Aesop's fables, or stories about Zeus and Apollo and all the Greek and Roman gods that even our kids today learn in elementary school, or even the great epic poems like Homer's Odyssey or Iliad. Everybody knew those stories about mythical figures who did daring deeds, but they also kind of knew they were made up. That there was no such thing really as Zeus. There was no such thing as a turtle and a rabbit that had a race. Those are all made up stories. If you grew up in the first century, you'd heard a lot of those stories, but you also knew, don't really build your life around that being true, because that didn't really happen. Luke writes to say, unlike the tortoise and the hare, unlike Odysseus or the Iliad, unlike Zeus and Apollo and all those other stories, this is real. We sometimes like to imagine, we 21st century folks, that we are so sophisticated, we easily can spot the made up from the real. We clearly know that the turtle and the hare are made up. And yet, man, it is sometimes so difficult to sort out what's real and what's made up in the culture we live in. Sometimes, man, it can feel like neighbors down the street or across the country live in a different reality with a different set of facts than we have, depending on what talking heads you listen to. We live in a time when something can be put up on the internet before anybody knows if it's real or not. We all share it with other people. It becomes really difficult to know what's real, what's solid, what's dependable, and what's made up or fits somebody's predetermined narrative. So to hear Luke say, I'm telling you a story that's real, man, that's good news. This isn't just, well, I want to believe it because it fits what I want to be true, or this is just a convenient story that is a nice fable to tell my kids at bedtime. This is true. This is solid. Yep, it really happened. You know, when Tiberius was emperor and Lysanias was ruler of Abilene, this is real. And then on top of that, notice that after giving us all that laundry list of who the world would have said was important back in the first century, and Luke has done his homework, he's given us all the people in powerful offices, the emperor, the Roman governor, all the local kings and princes, and even the high priests, and says, while all those people are doing their big important things that the world thought was so, so important, in the middle of nowhere, nobody was paying attention, in the backwoods where nobody was watching, God sends a guy named John. In other words, all the big names and so-and-sos think they're so important, but while everybody's back is turned, here God shows up in the middle of nowhere among people who are labeled nobodies in a province nobody cares about in the backwaters of the empire, people with no power, no prestige, no title, no degrees on their wall. There comes this guy named John, whose only credential is that God has raised him up to say God's doing something new. Love really is on the way. That's important. What God does in John is to meet us in the real world where we actually live and to say, even for folks like you and me who don't have power or prestige or titles, God is coming into your and my world and invites us to be a part of this new thing God is doing in real time in our real lived lives. We especially need those historical markers because it's so easy otherwise to take the words of Scripture and imagine they talk about some mythical distant past or some distant future or other people or powerful people, not you and me. Those beautiful words you heard Luke quote there about John's ministry was like the ancient words of Isaiah, prepare the way for the Lord, and every valley will be lifted up and every mountain will be brought up. Those are lovely words, but it's awfully easy to imagine. Maybe that's just another fable too. Maybe that's all just sort of wishful thinking that isn't real. And here Luke is saying, no, what God does in Jesus, what God does in John getting us ready for Jesus is real, and it meets us in this life, yours and mine. God doesn't just go to mythical, well-behaved people in some magical kingdom far, far away. God doesn't only show up in the distant future when we finally got our act together. God meets you and me in our broken places as we are, messy as we are. That's the other really beautiful thing about this introduction to John. When John shows up on the scene in the real world that you and I live in, he comes to real people who are messes like you and I. John's message is, hey, if you feel like you screwed up under a dead end, guess what? There's the possibility of a new beginning. That's really what it is when John says he's come bringing a message of repentance and forgiveness of sins. If you found yourself at some point in your life feeling like you were in a dead end, there really is a new beginning. There really is the possibility of starting over. God really is inviting you to be a part of this new thing. And this is not for mythical people in a fairy tale. It's for you as you are. There's no sense of, at some point in the distant future when you get your act together, then you're welcome on God's team. Or back in some distant mythical past when we all imagine things were better, then you're eligible. No, right? You as you are. Whatever broken places, whatever failures, whatever places, we keep blowing it, whatever we got in our hands. Jesus says, just as you are, come be a part of it. John announces it, come be part of this new thing God is doing. It's real. It's in this actual world that we live in. That's good news. I can't stop all the other messages you are going to be bombarded with probably before the end of the day, and all the challenging work you and I have to do, sorting through what's real, what's made up, what's half true, what's partially true. I can't stop or control that. But what you and I are given on this day is the bedrock assurance, the story of Jesus, the invitation of John to come be a part of what God's doing in Jesus. That's real, and it's for real people like you and me. As sure as you can feel the bread and taste it in your mouth, as sure as you can taste the cup, as sure as you can see the signs of people around you speaking, the peace of the Lord be with you, as sure as those things are, that's how certain, that's how real we can be. God has come to us in this world you and I live in as well. This isn't just a fairy tale. At the end of a lot of our bedtime story routines in our house, we sometimes have to have some kind of conversation like that with my kids. Sometimes with Anna, it will be an honest and good fairy tale. At the end, she'll have to ask, hey, could that be real? And I'm sorry, this is one that can't happen. Or as we've been wading through the Harry Potter books from time to time, Mark at the end of the night will go, oh man, I wish I had that kind of power. When I grew up, I want to have magic. And I had to stop him the other night. I seriously did that. Okay, but we're all clear. This is made up, right? Yeah, I know. The good news on a day like today is there never comes a point where we have to say, wouldn't it be great, but too bad, it's all made up. It's all a fairy tale. All this Jesus stuff, it's all made up. All this reign of God, it would be really nice, but it's all made up. Nope, it's for you. It's for me right here. Where we are. Not you if you could get back to some mythical time in your past when things were better. Not you in some imaginary space-based future where things are ideal. Right here, you and me as we are. The invitation is for you and me right now. Look around. Love really is on the way. Thanks be to God for that. Amen.
Stand and continue with the hymn of the day, number 249, on Jordan's Bank, the Baptist Cry.
one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and his Son, who with the Father and his Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
In this season of watching and waiting, let us pray for all people and places that yearn for God's presence. You send messengers into the world to proclaim the day of your coming. Make our bishops, pastors, deacons, and lay preachers confident in their preaching, that their words and our lives witness to your grace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Send your Spirit to all living creatures that are endangered. Provide them with shelter and care, and bring us into right relationship with the earth that you create and you call good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Send leaders to our nations, cities, schools, and businesses to work on behalf of those who have lost parents, spouses, and loved ones. Immigrants, the imprisoned, those living in poverty, and all who are oppressed. Make them bold in their commitments to justice and reconciliation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Send your servants to care for those who suffer. Use our ministries and our lives to reach out with compassion to those who are hungry, oppressed, lonely, or ill. Today we lift up to you Tom and Marge Bash, and also all COVID victims, those who are affected by the disease, those suffering and mourning, and for all the caregivers. We also lift up to you the family and friends of Deb Wright, Dan and Jillian Butler, Linda Fairman. Grant them healing and wholeness. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Send prophets to speak difficult truths, even when they are poorly received. Embolden those who ask hard questions and challenge accepted ways. Instill in youth and elders alike a passion for pointing to Jesus in all things. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Today we ask for traveling mercies for Doris and all those who are traveling during this holiday season. And we ask your blessing on all gatherings of friends and families. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
We remember your saints, both those publicly celebrated and those more humbly remembered. Confident that your work will be completed, we live in faith until the day of your coming. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
God of new life, you come among us in the places we least expect. Receive these prayers and those of our hearts in the name of Jesus. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
You're invited to share a sign of Christ's peace with one another.
Peace.
Thank you.
We sing as our sending hymn number 266, All Earth Is Joyful.